Reading something ahead, Commander. Looks to be a nebula.
Slow to warp factor 1, Lieutenant Jansen. Sensor scans, Mr. Bernstein.
It's not a nebula. I'm picking up several different kinds of energy. Radiation readings of a kind I've never seen before.
Put it on the main viewer.
We're heading right for it.
Should we wake the captain, sir?
Not necessary. Radiation and electromagnetic readings are well within our tolerance limit.
But doesn't the captain like to be notified whenever we come across something that might be considered unusual?
This poses no threat, Ensign. Take us through at warp 1. Survey and map it. The captain can review the computer logs over his morning coffee.
Going for a morning swim, Lieutenant.
You know there are green ladies at the pool, right? Oh, good morning, Ensign Isel.
Deltons.
Good morning, Ensign. I don't know if you can call turning the lights up at 0700 hours in the morning.
I don't understand it. I have not broken my vow. Yet I can feel it inside me.
What's wrong, Isel?
I'm pregnant, Doctor.
Space. The final frontier. These are the voyages of the starship Enterprise. Its five-year mission: to explore strange new worlds, to seek out new life and new civilizations, to boldly go where no man has gone before.
Medical log supplemental. After a pregnancy of only 3 days, rather than a normal 10-month Delton gestation period, Ensign Isel is about to give birth. The strange circumstances surrounding her pregnancy have raised deep concerns as to the nature of the infant.
Contractions are spaced at 2 minutes and regular, doctor. Dilation is 9 centimeters. The baby's heartbeat is normal.
I don't know how she's doing this. The strain on her body to adjust so quickly. If she wasn't a Delton.
There's nothing to worry about, doctor. She'll be out in a moment.
Are you having any pain?
Delton women experience childbirth as another kind of orgasm. We feel far more pleasure in it than pain.
Lucky you.
Indeed.
What the hell are you doing here?
Captain's orders, sir.
McCoy to Kirk.
Kirk here.
Damn it, Jim. Can't we let this woman have her child in peace?
A security officer's presence is normal procedure under these abnormal circumstances, Bones.
Now you can't tell me that a newborn infant seriously poses any kind of danger to the security of this vessel.
Bones.
I won't have it! This is my sickbay, and I won't have this baby born with a phaser pointed at his head.
Nobody's pointing any phasers, Doctor.
It's unwarranted, Captain, and it compromises the best care I can provide to my patients.
Ensign Kirk, please take up your position in the corridor outside of sickbay.
Aye, sir.
Thank you, Doctor.
Mr. Chekhov. Can you monitor this baby from here once it's been born?
Captain, given the bond between Delton mother and child, I feel that Ensign Isel would notice.
Just the same, I'd like you to monitor this as an intruder around the clock.
Sir, it's a baby.
Well, unless we can determine otherwise, this is an intruder masquerading as a baby.
Indeed. Considering the human instinct to trust and nurture an infant, an intruder could not choose a more perfect form.
Ah, Spock, but it's not just human nature we're talking about here, it's Delton nature as well. Delton mothers are the most fiercely protective in the galaxy, and I'm pretty sure that's why this entity chose her.
Captain, any species selecting a surrogate mother would naturally select the most protective one. The choice does not necessarily mean the entity is malevolent.
Well, it doesn't guarantee that it's not, either. What it does guarantee is that I'm going to be making some pretty unpopular decisions on this ship, until we can determine whether or not this really is a threat.
She's coming now, Doctor.
You were right. It was an easy delivery.
Delton's always know. You needn't have worried.
Now, don't patronize me, young lady. You know this was no ordinary delivery.
She never pretended it was, Doctor.
Have you thought of a name?
Irska, after the baby's father.
After its father?
Her father. Irska means pure light in Delton.
Sir, it's just a baby.
I wouldn't call immaculate conception after a 3-day pregnancy. No.
Then what's to become of it?
Kirk here.
Jim, I just did a complete scan of the cell's baby. You better get down here.
I'm on my way, Doctor. Mr. Spock, you have the con. What do you have for me, Bones?
Well, the child checks out as human in almost every respect.
No Delton characteristics?
None that I can detect.
Well, how the hell can that be?
I don't know.
What's even more incredible is how fast she's growing. Even faster now than in the cell's womb. By human standards, she's growing a little more than a year per day. Now, her metabolism is normal, which in theory means she can't possibly be processing enough food to account for the rate of growth we're observing.
Well, what would happen if I had them separated now?
No, you can't do that, Jim. For one thing, a cell would stop at nothing to get her back.
That child could pose a threat to the ship in ways that we can't even imagine. No matter how much a cell loves that child, that child was put inside her by an unknown alien for an unknown reason.
Well, it may be unusual, but it's not altogether unheard of for species to reproduce by depositing their eggs in unsuspecting hosts.
Exactly. And in almost every case, that life form that's reproducing is almost always a parasite.
Let me see if I can set your mind at ease. There's something else I haven't told you about a cell's baby. I don't think she's going to live out the week.
Why not?
She was born with an abnormally high white blood cell count, and it's steadily increasing. She has leukemia, and from all my studies, I don't believe she's going to respond to any known form of treatment.
Captain Kirk, please report to the bridge. We have an alien object approaching, 2,500 kilometers and closing.
Acknowledged, Mr. Spock. I'll be there momentarily. Go to yellow alert. Does the cell know?
Not yet.
Use your discretion, Bones. Any sign of hostility, Mr. Chekhov?
No, sir.
Sensor readings, Mr. Spock.
No mind forms.
You hedging your bet, Spock? You think there's something inside that thing?
Sensors indicate only a hollow tri-titanium shell surrounding a field of what could be dark light.
Dark light?
Analogous to dark matter, Captain. It seems to possess the energy of photons, but without the detectable wavelengths. There appeared to be some in a cloud that we encountered 4 nights ago.
The night a cell's child was conceived.
Precisely. But it is far more concentrated inside the cylinder. The shell exactly duplicates the alloy of our hull.
Well, that's no coincidence, Spock. Somebody's making a point about our technology.
Perhaps. Sensors show no signs of machinery on board of any kind, yet it appears to have no difficulty paralleling our course.
Well, how can that be?
It cannot be. Logic dictates there is a controlling life form that our sensors are failing to detect.
Lieutenant, hailing frequencies open.
Hailing frequencies open, sir.
This is Captain James T. Kirk of the Starship Enterprise. Identify yourself and your intentions.
No response, sir.
It seems safe to assume there's a connection between the object and the cell's child, Captain.
But we still don't know who's behind all of this, Spock. I mean, for all we know, it could be a cell's child causing this.
It has made no hostile gestures, sir.
Scan it again, Mr. Spock. This time, a little more aggressively. If it thinks we're trying to scan it, maybe it'll take the time to contact us. I want to know what the hell I'm dealing with before I have to do anything about it.
Mother. Irska. Mother. Irska. Mother. Irska.
Captain's log, Stardate 9717.7. A week has passed since the birth of Isel's child and the appearance of the strange alien cylinder. Despite an ever-increasing white blood cell count,
Irska remains healthy. Her stage of development is now roughly that of a 10-year-old child. We remain unable to make contact with the alien cylinder or to determine why or even how it is following us.
Today I resume my duties. That means we'll be apart for a time.
Can't I work with you?
No. My work is my work. It's important now for you to spend time alone, to become what you are to be.
What will I do?
Whatever you want. Learn. Discover joyfulness alone. Once you achieve that, you need never fear rejection.
Come.
I would like permission to resume my duties, Captain.
And what about your daughter?
She's busy learning to have a good relationship.
With whom?
Herself. She must be alone and get to know herself before sharing herself with others.
Isel, have you made any plans for you and your daughter?
Plans? I must love her, teach her what I can, and let her go.
Go? Go where? To do what? Appearances to the contrary, she's not human, and she's not Delton, nor is she any other race that we're familiar with. Do you really think she can adjust to that kind of aloneness?
Captain, she is my child. Even if we are physically separated, the bond between us is inseparable. Where she goes and what she does must be left up to her.
And what if she were to pose some kind of danger?
She does not, could not pose danger to anyone.
Do you have any idea whether or not she's connected to that cylinder out there?
No. None at all, I'm sorry.
Very well, Ensign. Thank you. You can return to duty now.
Thank you, sir.
We're relieved, Mr. Chekhov. Thanks for taking over for me.
It was my pleasure. And how is the beautiful Irska today?
She's just marvelous.
Something is being beamed aboard from the alien cylinder.
It's roughly 1 cubic centimeter of dark light atmosphere contained in the cylinder.
Find it and isolate it.
It is in our number 10 filter of our atmospheric purification system. We've isolated the filter and are redirecting the airflow.
What's the problem, Spock?
A small quantity of dark light was beamed into our filtration system. Lieutenant Chekhov contained it as quickly as possible. However, it is an extreme biotoxin, and we were exposed to a lethal dose 2.3 seconds after it arrived. Unless Dr. McCoy can counteract it within 6.2 hours, it will kill us all.
Captain's log supplemental. It has now been more than 4 hours since the alien craft beamed a deadly portion of its atmosphere into our ship. So far, Dr. McCoy has made little progress toward finding a cure for its effects. The crew is already displaying symptoms of the dark light toxin, and though they continue to maintain the ship's routine, many of them have become despondent, hopeless.
Which one is this?
NK-17 platelets with monocyte serum. Any luck?
Worthless. Next.
I'm sorry. I didn't mean to hurt you.
It's all right, lass. Why aren't you with your mother?
She's at the bridge, and Captain Kirk doesn't like me to be there.
So you came down to see old Mr. Scott? You know, you're the only wee lass I've ever known who could see the beauty in an engineering schematic.
I see beauty in almost everything, Mr. Scott.
I got a present for you. It's like your mother's.
Oh, Mr. Scott. It's beautiful. Thank you.
Is it possible that they're being remotely controlled somehow?
If that is the case, then it is being done from a greater distance than our long-range scanners can detect.
Well, something moved the dark light into our air supply. There must be an intelligent life form behind all of this. I'm convinced that they know what they're doing to us.
Possibly. Or it could be studying us, learning how the toxins affect us. If it simply wanted to kill us, I suspect it could do so far more efficiently.
Well, that's comforting.
Really?
No, Mr. Zahn. Not really. Bones, progress report.
None. The toxin makes changes to the protein in our cells that I can't begin to understand. I'm just flying blind, hoping to get lucky, Jim.
We've got less than 2 hours.
Doctor, when was the last time you examined Irska?
Damn it, Spock! I don't have time to do a complete physical. I'm trying to create a vaccine!
If she and the object are in fact connected, then Irska could provide a key to counteracting the toxin.
Fine. Then send her down. I can't do any worse than I'm doing now.
Captain, if this is absolutely necessary, I'd like to be with her for the examination. I don't want her to be frightened or think she's done something wrong.
You can't interfere with what the doctor has planned.
I understand.
Get her to sit there, fast.
Bring her here.
I thought you wanted to stay with your daughter.
She knew I would feel any pain that she felt, and that my pain would be greater than hers.
Won't you feel it just as much here?
Only if I focus on it, and she asked me not to. She felt it would make the process more difficult for her.
I'm sorry that all this was necessary. Why did you do that?
To make a connection.
A sexual connection?
I'm Dalton. Any meaningful contact between us will feel sexual to you.
And do you think you could use that to influence me?
Captain, do you know why Deltons agree to take oaths of celibacy?
Because Starfleet requires you to.
Beyond that, we live to connect as deeply as possible with other beings. Putting a limit on our ability to do so heightens all our senses to compensate for what we're missing. So the process of being less Delton makes us even more Delton.
So what's your point, Ensign?
The only bond stronger than that between Delton lovers is the bond between a Delton mother and her child. You felt a powerful connection when I touched you, but my bond with Irska is infinitely deeper. I can sense all her feelings. Even the difference between how a food tastes to me and how it tastes to her. I hope that my touch would help you to understand how I can know that my daughter is no threat to this ship.
Well, that cylinder attacked this ship and poisoned our air. And you know they're connected somehow.
She feels a connection but has no sense of its nature.
Attacking that cylinder could harm Irska. That's why you're here.
My daughter is innocent. I would know if she were not. She is not responsible for what the cylinder does.
Well, the evidence suggests that she may not be directing it. But it probably wouldn't be here otherwise. Come.
Well, I've deployed medics to all decks dispensing injections. I thought you'd like yours as soon as possible.
Bones, you found a cure.
Dr. McCoy taught me all about life and death.
Well, thank my young assistant here. She had the cure inside her a week before we even needed it. Those strange white corpuscles of hers adapted to the toxin and neutralized it.
Has she been affected in any other way?
Just her miraculous blood adaptation.
Captain, our hull is being penetrated by an energy beam of unknown nature from the alien cylinder. Shields are ineffective.
I'm on my way.
Impulse engine plasma cooling unit 2. The coil and shutdown servos.
Evasive maneuvers.
Impulse engine plasma is overheating, Captain.
Locked phasers on target.
Locked on target, sir.
Captain, the alien has disengaged its energy beam.
Hold your fire, Mr. Sulu. Why did they stop?
I believe the attack was disengaged because it has completed its goal. Our impulse engine plasma cooling coil has ruptured. The attack was broken off at the exact instant the rupture occurred.
Why would they do that, Mr. Spock? What point does it serve?
Unknown, Captain.
We've got a mess down here, Captain. The impulse engines are spewing out plasma and we can't shut them down. Ensign Hemmons is in there trying to get a better look.
Keep me posted, Mr. Scott.
Well, as always, that green blood of yours proved to be a particular pain in my posterior.
Look, there's a leak in number 2 cooling coil.
Yes, we know.
You have to fix it, or the impulse engine will explode.
How did you know that?
Mr. Scott showed me all the technical manuals.
Medical team to engineering. Lieutenant Ross has taken a massive dose of theta radiation.
Captain, the automatic system has failed. I'll seal the tube manually for now, but the leak has released some pure theta ionized plasma.
Can you stop it?
Our only hope is to pass the coil. One man could weld a patch in about 15 minutes.
Captain, theta radiation in the access tube is too intense. Even with a protective suit, no one could remain conscious in there for more than a few minutes.
Get down there, see if you can lend a hand. Sulu, how much time do we have?
89 minutes.
She's right, Captain.
Stay on it, Mr. Scott.
Young lady, you'll have to come with me.
But can't I? Ow!
I'm sorry. I need you to come with me. Please.
You too, Mr. Spock.
The theta plasma levels are in red zone proximity. Keep the exhaust manifolds on full, or I'm a dead man.
Aye, sir.
I'm considering a mind melt. I don't think it would work, Captain. His cell would sense it instantly, and I would be flooded with her feelings as well.
What's a mind melt?
Great. Delton sensitivity and ears like a Vulcan.
A mind meld is a technique that would let us share each other's thoughts.
I'd like that.
Yes, I'd like that too, but now is not the time.
Your mother has the ability to sense aspects of things that she can't see or touch. Can you do this as well?
Yes, I think so.
Can you try for me? Can you try very hard? Are you able to sense anything about the cylinder that's following the ship?
Send a medical team.
Mr. Scott is down.
Jim, I should see the Scotty.
In a minute, Bones.
I need to know if Irska's blood will adapt to the Theta radiation.
It's possible.
It can. I know it can.
You cannot allow this. I won't allow it. She's just a child.
I want to. I can save the ship and Mr. Scott.
That's not your job.
Yes, it is. If I fix the leak, my blood will adapt to the Theta radiation, and Dr. McCoy can use it to save Mr. Scott, just like last time.
Sweetheart, we don't know that your blood will adapt again.
She's right. We can't know for sure.
However, Ensign, I believe it's highly likely her blood will adapt as needed.
You may be willing to risk my daughter's life on highly likely, but I am not.
Ensign, the impulse engines will explode inside of an hour if we don't fix that leak. All of our lives are at risk. Your daughter is the only person capable of staying conscious long enough inside that tube to fix it.
You don't know she can stay conscious in there.
We know that nobody else can.
Mommy, Mr. Scott is my friend. I don't want him to die. Please.
We need to get that suit of him. Get Dr. McCoy down here now.
Decker to Captain.
Kirk here, how's Scotty?
Critical.
McCoy's on his way. I'll be on the bridge.
I should be going. Despite my fear, I cherish that you have learned to love others so much that you want to do this.
I'll be all right, Mother. Really.
Any activity from the cylinder, Mr. Seward?
None, sir.
How long until impulse engine meltdown?
20 minutes, sir.
Mr. Scott already applied the patch to the leak. So, all you have to do is use this torch along the edges of the patch to seal it. It's operated by...
Mr. Scott showed me yesterday. You just press this button.
The edges of the seal will change color from red to blue as it seals. And the gas should stop escaping.
Don't worry, I can do it.
All right, let's go.
Well, there's nothing more we can do. We can only hope that Irska's blood will adapt to the Theta radiation.
I gotta start preparing the medium for the serum right now, Doctor. We might as well be ready.
Do it. I'll be on the bridge.
We're ready.
I see the patch.
Remember to keep the torch in place until the red line turns blue. Then move it to the next bit of red.
I will.
How long has she been in there?
3.2 minutes longer than Mr. Scott.
Well, that's a good sign.
The pattern of recent events indicates she will succeed in her task and suffered no ill effects from the radiation doctor. However, the same pattern dictates a new crisis will follow swiftly upon resolution of this one.
No life form in the galaxy can spoil good news faster than your average Vulcan.
I may as well head back to sick bay and start getting ready.
Captain, I suggest a mind meld with Irska. Her subconscious may well hold the reason for these consecutive crises.
I mentioned that earlier to Spock, and he thought the child's connection to her mother would make it unlikely to succeed.
For him? Perhaps.
Mr. Spock has struggled his entire life to suppress emotion. For me, it is effortless. I would have less chance of being overwhelmed.
Are you saying this could be more dangerous than usual?
Undoubtedly. But I suspect the risk will be necessary.
Let's hope not. For now, we have more pressing matters to deal with. How much time do we have, Mr. Chekov?
4 minutes, Captain.
Engineering, stand by to recharge impulse engine coolers on my command.
Aye, Captain.
Have to work quickly, Irska.
1 minute to impulse engine meltdown.
Engineering, recharge impulse engine coolers now.
Recharging, sir. Plasma levels returning to normal.
Impulse engine temperature is coming down, Captain.
Ensign Kirk, escort Irska to sickbay on the dump.
Captain, I think that the alien object is attacking us again.
You think? What's it doing?
I don't know, Captain, but something is affecting the integrity of our hull.
On screen, now.
There's no apparent energy being applied to us, but somehow the atoms of our hull are being manipulated below the quantum level.
Is the object causing it?
Unknown, sir, but the object is experiencing the same effect.
Evasive maneuvers, Mr. Sulu, take us away from it.
Antimatter imbalance, Captain. Warp drive engine shutting down.
What the hell is going on?
I can only estimate. But if the manipulation continues at the present rate, our ship's hull will cease to exist in something less than 14 minutes.
Mr. Spock, take the con. Mr. Zahn, you're with me.
You, my dear, have the most amazing blood any doctor has ever encountered. With you around, I could cure just about anything.
I have the medium already. I will have the serum in no time.
I need Mr. Zahn to mind meld with your daughter now.
Is that wise?
Melding with her melds with me and everyone close to me.
Wise or not, it's the only way I'm going to understand the threat to this ship.
Irska?
I'd be happy to join minds with Mr. Zahn. Wouldn't it be funny if we taught him how to laugh?
Very funny, darling.
My mind to your mind. Your thoughts. My thoughts.
Captain's log supplemental. An unknown entity believed connected to Isel's mysterious daughter is poised to destroy our ship in less than 12 minutes. Lieutenant Zahn, our best chance to understand this entity's motives lies unconscious in sickbay.
I can try, but I could just as easily kill him.
There is another way.
No, Spock!
I can't risk losing you both. Lieutenant Zahn is no longer in contact with Isel and Irska. Whatever shock resulting from that contact has already processed. I would be melding Vulcan to Vulcan, which essentially should be safe. Bont.
Well, should be safe isn't the same as safe. And there's no way I can predict the risk. I mean, I consider it a small miracle if I can cure a Vulcan of a headache.
Vulcans do not get headaches, Doctor.
I rest my case.
Do it, Spock.
Spock! Spock! Phones, give him a shot. Get him out of here. Spock, what happened?
I was overwhelmed with a sensation. A sense of connection unlike any I've known. It was intoxicating. Perhaps it was dealt in love. Perhaps it was from the alien entity.
I do not know.
Did you find any connection between Irska and the Entity?
Only one word, sir. Cryantha. Cryantha. Cryantha.
Cryantha? What does it mean?
Unknown, sir.
Spock, use the ship's computer and run a search for the word Cryantha.
Good.
Send a broadcast Cryantha to the alien cylinder on all frequencies.
Broadcasting.
Mr. Kirk, lock phasers on the alien cylinder.
Arming phasers, locking on target.
No response, sir.
If they won't respond to one kind of communication, maybe they'll respond to another. Fire.
Stop it, Captain! She's fired!
I'm sorry. I didn't want to hurt you. You realize this proves the connection between your daughter and the Entity.
What do you intend to do, Captain?
I don't know. But I'm not going to let this ship be destroyed without a fight.
Captain, I found a reference to Cryantha. It was prominent in hieroglyphs found in ruins of an advanced civilization on a planet abandoned by its inhabitants over 100 million years ago.
What does it mean, Spock?
The translation is believed to be unnecessary shell.
Unnecessary shell.
There may be a connection, Captain, as the planet is located not far from where Isel was impregnated.
Irska, does a necessary shell mean anything to you?
No, sir.
Think hard. Think very hard. Cryantha. Unnecessary shell. Did you think of something?
I don't know. I don't think so.
Ensign Isel, hold your daughter.
What are you going to do? Look, the phasers didn't do anything!
They sent a message. I have no choice but to send it back. Mr. Kirk, fire phasers.
No! Mommy!
Security team to the bridge. Your mother's going to be all right.
All integrity compromised. Total hull failure will occur in 7 minutes.
Shut that damn thing off. Take Ensign Isel and her daughter to her quarters and see to it that they stay there.
Phasers and photon torpedo controls are both out, Captain.
Go to auxiliary.
Captain, Isel was right. Despite the pain to the child, the alien cylinder experienced no damage. I believe additional firing would only hurt the child.
No need to be frightened. You've only felt pain.
Why must anyone feel pain?
It's part of life. Sometimes it's how we understand.
Can you make me understand what Cryantha is?
It's inside your mind. Only you can find it.
And if I don't, everyone will die.
Don't use your mind to feel guilt. Ask yourself what Cryantha is and just let the answer come.
Mr. Spock said it meant a necessary shell.
That's what it means to him. Discover what it means to you.
Mr. Spock, how much time?
Approximately 5 minutes, Captain.
Metallurgy, report.
No progress on a catalyzing agent, Captain.
Physics lab, report.
We've tried reverse gravity and a battery of magnetic field generators. No effect, sir.
Bones, what's your status?
All the Theta radiation patients have responded to treatment, Jim. And Nurse Mateo's on her way to the bridge with Mr. Zahn.
The minute he regained consciousness, he insisted in coming up here.
Are you all right, Mr. Zahn?
The Delta impressions were stronger than anticipated, but I will recover. What you must know is each of the calamities to befall our ship was intended to teach Irska something about life, death, and emotions I could not comprehend. Irska feels incomplete, but does not know why.
Well, what about Cryantha? What is Cryantha?
I do not know, but I believe it to be the key to her next stage of development.
No! I'm not ready to lose you.
You can never lose me. That's why you were chosen.
But I will lose this. And this.
We will touch in other ways.
I know. We must hurry.
Spock, what's going on?
I know, Captain, but quantum manipulation of the atoms in our hull is no longer synchronized with those of the cylinder.
All decks, this is security. Ensign Isel and her daughter have escaped from their quarters.
Scanning all decks, Captain. I have them. Ensign Kirk, get to the transport room on the double and detain them.
Spock, you're with me.
Let her go! The unnecessary shell is my body!
No!
Forgive me, Jim. There was no time to explain.
Where did you send her?
She sent Irska into the cylinder.
You killed her?
No, Captain. Her body was the unnecessary shell. She learned to let it go.
The alien cylinder has vanished, Captain, and our hull has returned to normal.
Stand down for red alert, Mr. Chekhov.
Thousands of centuries ago, Irska's race existed in human form. Just as humans pass through all evolutionary stages, from single cell to human being within the mother's womb, Irska had to experience all stages of her race's prior development.
So what you're saying is that Irska hasn't even really been born yet.
Until she had experienced all joys and pains of living in a body, and was ready to shed the unnecessary shell it represented to her, she was still in an embryonic state for her race. I was her first womb. The Enterprise was her second.
I wish her life with you could have been longer. And I wish there was some way I could have made it easier for both of you.
Thank you, Captain. I appreciate your sentiments, but only our physical connection has been broken. Besides,
hardly expect you to make improvements on a miracle.